The coroner's wagon was just pulling away when I got to him. Father Leahy had disappeared. I saw a light in the rectory, so I went upstairs and rang the bell. He came to the door in his shirt sleeves. He just stood there for a minute looking at me. Then he motioned me inside. You want to see me, Father?
Yes. Be here. Sit down.
The kid, Father. Little Jake.
What do you think?
Well, he goes fast?
Instantly.
I'll get the guy, Father.
I'm not asking that, Patsy. I'm not asking you for anything anymore. Unless I need trouble.
No, somebody told you a bad story, Father. That wasn't my gun.
I should have known better than to call you. I should have known it meant trouble. It's your middle name, Patsy. You're married to it.
You're looking at the wrong man. It wasn't my party.
I called you here tonight to ask you a favor, Patsy.
Anything you want, Father.
It's too late now. We were going to have an outer boys picnic tomorrow at Paradise Cove. I wanted to borrow one of your boats. We won't be going now, Patsy. We've got a funeral instead.
Yeah. What do you want me to say?
Don't say anything, Patsy. Just listen for a minute. I asked you to come up here tonight, but I didn't tell you to bring your friends. If you've got any private fights with those waterfront hoods, that's your business. But don't bring your beasts into the church.
And I tell you, I never saw the guy before. I don't know anything about it.
He was shooting at you when he hit little Jake, wasn't he? What else am I supposed to think?
Yeah. They'll find him where he's done.
Nothing you'll bring me for me, Patsy.
I liked you better without the temper, Father.
And I liked you better before your hands got dirty, Patsy. I warned you about that waterfront crowd, the cheap thugs, the cheap women. I told you, Patsy, roll around in dirt long enough and some of it's bound to stick to you. You got it all over your face and your hands, and it's working inside you, Patsy. It's working in deep.
That's the end of the sermon, Father.
I tried to warn you, but you had a figure. Well, figure this one, Patsy. There's a 9-year-old kid on his way to the morgue. He stepped in front of a bullet and saved your life. Now go ahead. Figure.
Yeah, I will, Father. But you better be on call when I catch up with the guy. He's going to have a lot of praying to do. When I left Father Leahy, I checked in at the church for one more look around. A couple of red-faced Irish cops in uniform were wandering around the vestibule trying to look at home and chewing gum like mad to kill the beer on their desk. And over in one corner, half a dozen old women had their heads together clucking like hens over a square egg. Outside of them, the place was deserted. I gave the course a quick rundown. A couple of hours over, where I figured the denser must have passed, I picked up a matchbook. The ad on the front said Match Joint, Cicero, Illinois. And there was a phone number scrawled inside the cover. I was just about ready to toss it away when a bell rang, and I took a closer look. It was my phone number. I put the matchbook in my pocket, and I started home for the apartment. Maybe the cab wasn't going fast enough because halfway there, 3 years' stock of headache caught up with me and the ceiling started to jump. Well, the cab driver was kind, though. When we got to my place, he offered to help me as far as the curb for an extra 4 bits. By the time I made it to my front door, I was feeling lower than any man of an Irish wake. The reception committee didn't help much. They were short and dark, all three of them, with rows of loose, oily fat where their necks should have been, and small pig eyes that squinted through the cigar smoke rolling out of wide nostrils and up their faces.
Hiya, Novak. How do you feel?
Lots better after you find the door.
Hey, Jack. Novak don't like it. He'll cultivate a case.
No, they don't build stomachs that strong.
Say nice. It's easier that way.
Now look, Buster, I don't know who you three pigs are.
Novak. Remember, be nice.
Yeah, I remember.
You West Coast punks are all alike, Novak. Couple of taps and you cry. Ain't that right, Lud?
Maybe Novak's tired, fellas. Help him into a chair.
Yeah, Novak. Sit down. Lud wants to say something.
All right, then say it and get out of here.
We want the gun, Novak. And we want the papers that go with it.
Sounds like a great puzzle. Sorry, I can't help with the answer.
You better tell Lud, Novak. It's liable to get rough.
All right. My gun's over there in the desk, and the paper's on the wall.
Be nice, Novak. Just once more, Novak. Where's the gun, and where's the papers?
Look, I'll spell it for you. I don't know what you're talking about.
All right. Beck, Max, get his arm. Yeah. All right, hold his head up. Yeah. Okay, Lud, there.
Is this the way they do it in Cicero?
Last time round, Novak, the gun and the papers. Where are they?
I don't know.
The gun, Novak. The papers.
No use, boss. We lost them.
All right. It's a big flaw. Let him find his own way back.
For summer. When I woke up, the sun was bleeding through a rip in the blinds, and there was a funny smell in the room. My stomach felt like a piece of practice rope at a Boy Scout class. And then the room got noisy.
You wake up slow, Novak. Have a hard night?
Well, you're never on time for the party, are you, Hellman?
I'm choosy, Novak. I don't like your friends.
Well, I can pick up social work. What's the occasion?
I got a phone tip. Gonna drop up for a visit.
You having fun?
Yeah. There's a gal in the kitchen bored to death.
Huh?
Take a look.
Hard. Who is she?
Sally Kimball. That's what her driver's license says. You a friend of yours?
How would I know? Even her mother couldn't tell.
Messed up, isn't she, Novak? Must have been a rough party.
I wouldn't know, Hellman. I closed early.
It's your joint. What happened?
I said I closed early. Three gunsels were drinking my scotch when I got home about 10:30. They were anxious about a gun and some papers, and they figured I could put them straight. I couldn't, so they laid me out. Now tell me how sorry you are.
I plead for you, Novak. Now let's have it straight.
That's as straight as you're going to get it, Hellman. If it's not exciting enough, try Esquire.
You talk straight for a funk in hot water.
I'm not going to scream till it burns.
Then you better start practicing, Novak, because I'm going to burn you.
You better hurry, Hellman. Your pension's catching up with you.
Watch your mouth, Novak. You're not talking to your gentle friend.
Well, that's hard to tell, Hellman. You both use the same technique. Now show me the warrant before I start charging your rent.
That dame's body is all the warrant I need, Novak. Now talk. How did she get so dead?
I told you once. Pick up the three gunsels and ask them what they look like.
Like you.
The size smaller. They're from the east around Chicago.
What else?
They wouldn't leave their birth certificate.
Go ahead, smart boy. Get in all the laughs you can. But don't ask me to con the parole board for you.
Oh, I don't know, Hellman. You won't be there. Maybe I'll like prison life. You might as well throw him away and take your chances barefoot. Hellman and his boys left with the body, and I grabbed a handful of aspirin and a cold shower. Then I started out to look for the only honest guy I know, an ex-doctor and a boozer by the name of Jocko Madigan. A pretty smart man until he found out you can poison your worries at $4 a fifth. I finally found him sitting in the middle of a bourbon fog in a little Spanish joint somewhere on the edge of the Excelsior district. He was down at the end of the bar, trying his best to make time with a plaster bust of Queen Isabella.
Jetsy, your
Jetsy's
Andrew short one.
Bartender, hand me that
vein. Come on, Jocko, sober up. I gotta talk to you.
Pepsi, here's to your own peculiar brand of happiness.
Jocko, will you cut it out?
Pepsi, I don't mean to be rude or ungentlemanly, but I don't think I altogether approve of the clientele in this place.
Well,
this woman next to me, Pepsi, the one with the stony gaze, she's been here ever since I came in. And I don't mean to be uncharitable, but I think she's the picture of a perfect boy.
All right.
Patsy, to a member of the old Castilian school, there can be no excuse for the conduct she's exhibited. Why, do you know I was even good enough to buy her three rounds of Portuguese brandy? Imported, mind you. But what do I get for my pains? Not even a civil thank you.
All right, Jocko.
I've been sitting here in the most gentlemanly way, sipping this delicate nectar in great mouthfuls and trying to keep the party going. But does she help? No. I've talked to her about politics, medicine, literature, Keats, Byron, Shelley, Nick Kenny. I even talked about the weather.
Jocko, she's a statue.
A simple oversight, Patsy. Might happen to anyone.
Listen a minute, will you? I'm in trouble.
You're always in trouble, Patsy. And that's the way you stay till you find some kind of moral rudder. You've got to find direction instead of trying to be so righteous in an evil sort of way. Get in tune with our decaying civilization. Like me, Patsy. Why tempt the fates? It's much more practical to buy off your destiny with a good sip of Irish whiskey.
You are too, Jocko.
Yes. What kind of trouble this time?
Three gentles from the east. They're shooting up the town and I'm running front for their murder rap.
Patsy, why not plead guilty? The rest might do you good.
Somebody shot a 9-year-old kid, an altar boy.
Oh. Where did that happen?
In Father Lady's church. The gunfire took me for somebody else and started shooting.
Problem's getting bigger, Patsy. What am I supposed to do?
I want you to check on a guy by the name of Mike Quinlan. Also a girl, Sally Kimbrough. Tagged by the Examiner and the Chronicle Morgue and moved around the horse parlors out on Eddie Street, will you? Find out everything you can.
All right, Patsy, but you've broken up a beautiful party. You disillusioned me about Queen Isabella here, and I've suddenly grown dreadfully thirsty again. Let's have 4 or 5 for the road, shall we?
Later, Jocko, we haven't got time.
Well, only if you say so, Patsy. But every time I leave the hallowed confines of a barroom, I'm a poor pilgrim caught up in the vices of the crass everyday world. A tattered orphan leaning disconsolately against the bitter winds of chance. Tossed and buffeted about endlessly by the cruel storms of fortune. By the way, I need carfare.
All right, here, half a buck.
But, Patsy, refreshment.
Later, you know, get going, will you, Jocko?
Where can I find you?
I'm going to check by my office, and I'm going to see Father Leahy.
Well, as soon as he mentions taking the pledge, that's your cue to leave. Good night, lover.
Downtown, and on the way, I started hunting for just a piece of the answer. But all I got was questions. Who were the 3 gunfolk, and what was the stuff they were after? Mike Quinlan, where did he fit in? And that dead girl in my apartment, who did she belong to? Then the zeros were piling up faster than flies on donuts when the cab pulled up for a stop sign at 16th and Mission, and a little guy with a worried mouth and a loud sports shirt jumped in. His lips were wound around a phony kind of smile, like a head waiter just before he hands you the check for a big party.
It's okay, driver. We're friends.
How are you, Miss? Friends just come easy for you, mister. You got a name?
Keith Novak. I want to talk.
That's from the next corner.
We both mean it, Novak. Me and the gun.
Now, look, Junior, if you want to play the heavy, go find a melodrama.
Who are you working for?
Sandell.
That's as good a name as any. All right, here's your corner.
Charlie Kimbrough. Where is he, Novak?
You're fast with a question, mister. Let me ask you one. Who's Sandell?
I got the gun, Novak.
Yeah, but who's Sandell?
I'll do the asking. You sit there and make the answer.
Well, you're running out of tickets, Junior. Come here. All right, now reach down for that gun and I'll jam you through the floorboards. Who's Sandell?
The Chicago hood. He's out to get me. Works both ways.
That's a good plot. Now, who are you?
Mike Quinlan. All right, now what about Charlie Kimbrough?
They mopped her up off my kitchen floor this morning.
Somebody's going to get Sandell.
Maybe we're on the same train. What's he look like?
Fat men all look alike.
All right, you can leave any time now.
Sure, Novak. Fare's getting high. See you later.
Than a Mexican divorce. The black sedan pounded by on all 12 and Quinlan folded up like a playpen in a high wind. We tried to follow the car, but it would have been easier to win the Kentucky Derby on a pogo stick. So I went back to the corner where Quinlan was still hugging the cement. He was draped over the curb like a tired carpet, and if his suit was a brighter yellow, he could have passed for a loading zone. Hellman was there with all his relatives in uniform, so I told the cabbie to drive on. I just couldn't seem to shake the picture of little Jake when he went quiet in that shirt. Well, when I got close to a phone, I paid off the cabbie and I put in a call to Jocko. I called Newton at the examiner morgue and he said that Jocko had just left, so I called Breen. I asked for the guy who was drinking the cheapest whiskey and the tallest glass.
Jocko Madigan speaking.
This is Novak. How'd you make out?
Let me tell you about these fancy newspaper men down here. Men of high birth, Patsy. True breeding. They like Scotch almost as much as I do.
What'd you find out about Quinlan?
My Eddie Street informant tagged him as an ex-con, Patsy. Sent up for armed robbery in 1940 and paroled about 2 weeks ago from Joliet. Quinlan had a few dealings with a man named Lutz Sandell. From what I can gather, Quinlan's supposed to have taken the rap with Sandell and his brother.
What else?
Quinlan's a local boy out of Fern Isle Heights. He has a sister, Patsy. She belongs to Sandell. She's probably the only sales girl in town with a 6-room apartment in the best part of the marina.
You get the address?
Bayview Towers, down at the foot of Fillmore Street.
Sounds good.
Maybe she has a friend.
Did you get anything else on Sandell?
The Turk Street set tells me he's out here to set up a slot machine route. I gather he's the pushy type.
Thanks, Jocko. I'll see you at the apartment.
Oh, Patsy, on your way home, pick up something for dinner at the delicatessen, will you?
There's stuff in the icebox. Fix yourself a sandwich.
Patsy, dinner without bourbon is life without hope. I'll borrow from the neighbors. Good night, lover.
Well, Van Ness Avenue, and I headed down into the marina. Her answer box was still stuck with questions, and little Jake Stiller held a four-lap lead, but at least the field was getting thin. I figured it was one out of three. Sandell or either one of his gentles, but which one? Well, when I got down to the foot of Fillmore Street, the fog was thicker than ankles at a fat ladies' convention, and the foghorns out beyond Yacht Harbor started on overtime. The Bayview Towers was one of those swanky, new-looking places that gets old in a hurry. It saw lots of brass and brunettes during the war, but now the only uniform left belonged to the doorman. I found Quinlan's sister in the penthouse apartment. And when she opened the door, it felt like Clyde Beatty with a broken chair. Her lounging pajamas were managed with a good butler. They came in and went out at the right places and then stayed close to the job. I felt like the fifth boy after somebody blew out his candle.
Oh, talent on the loose. Want to come in?
Yeah, sure, Terrence. My name's Novak. I got some news for you.
I'm Bobby Quinlan. Don't go so fast.
I'm looking for answers, lady. If you want a companion, advertise. Your brother's dead. Sandell shot him.
My, such a big imagination, Mr. Novak. Why don't you relax?
Look, I got proof in my pocket, baby. You want the rest of this couch now?
I'll send you lunch, Mr. Novak.
It's going to get worse with your brother gone. Take a look at the paper.
Look.
Yeah, have you been practicing?
Look at him, Patsy. I can feel your heart pounding.
Yeah, now let's quiet down and talk murder, shall we?
Patsy, you're hurting. You're hurting me.
Where's Sandell?
Patsy.
Where's Sandell? Where is he?
In my arm, you'll break it.
Tear it off and throw it away. Now, where's Sandell?
I don't know. I swear I don't.
He killed your brother. He shot him down on the street.
The phone dress, Novak.
All right, if you won't believe me, take a look at this chronicle. Right there on the front page.
You're lying, Novak.
Look at it.
No. Sandell promised. Promise he wouldn't touch Mike.
Why complain? Think how Mike feels. Now, where's Sandell?
He's down at the hotel. The Durban Arms on Eddie Street. He lied to me, Novak. I played it straight, but he lied to me.
Yeah, you're a mistake, baby. I'll see you later.
Don't leave, Novak.
Beck, why'd you do it? You lied. You and Sandell, you promised me. And you killed him.
Emma, somebody had to go.
Like that older boy, huh?
Once, Novak, it's tougher the second time.
There's no second time death.
All right, sweetheart, now take him back.
Yeah, you're finished even, baby.
Promise me, Pat. I've been lying. See me, Sandell. It's so much. It's right. Oh, me. Hold me, Pat.
Sorry, baby, you make this trip alone. There wasn't anything I could do for them, so I took a cab down to the Durban Arms on Eddy Street, but Sandell had checked out an hour before. The clerk told me his baggage was still around, though, so I figured that could only mean one thing. I put in a call for Hellman, and then I grabbed the cab and headed for Father Lacey's. By the time I got up on the hill, a fog had taken a lease on most of the town. You can always tell when it's thick because all the sounds out in the bay get a free ride. Halfway there, the driver was ready to quit, but for an extra $2, he threw the cab in second and we crawled the rest of the way till we got a block from the church. By that time, the fog was so thick you could have sold it for the pound. I did the last block on foot. I was just about 20 yards away when I spotted Sandell and Max the Gentle standing under a streetlight just outside the door to the church. They waited a minute, and then they turned and started up the steps. Don't bother, Sandell. You called too late.
Huh? Who is it? Who's out there? It's a smart one, Novak.
Novak.
Come closer. I can't see you in the fog.
Go on out and get me, Sandell.
Tell you, man.
You're flying blind, Sandell. You made the trip for nothing. I got the gun and I got the papers.
He's lying, lot. Come on out, Novak. The deal.
I said you're late, Sandell. I already made the deal with Matt.
You're funny, Novak. This'll shut you up.
Not even close, Matt. Which one have you got the order, boy?
You sound worried, Novak. You want to tell him
lot
or should I?
Matt's deal's a lot better than you shoot, Sandell. Ask him about it.
Huh? What's he saying,
Matt?
He's saying nothing, lot. He's talking crazy. Let's go out and get him.
Ask Matt about this afternoon, Sandell. Ask him where he was when Jack got it. Ask him how I got the gun and the papers.
He's crazy, lad. Not so sure, Matt.
Don't be a sucker, love. Novak plant cute.
Sorry, Matt. You took the chance.
He's turning, you bloody liar.
Good thing, Matt, but I can't chance.
Oh.
All right, Sandell. Now it's just you and me in the fog.
Come on in, Novak. We'll work it with you. Come in where I can see you.
All right. That's five shots, Lud. You got one left to make good on.
No, like Sandell, no, even.
Come here.
Let me go, Novak. Lay you off, Novak. What'd I do to you? Cut it out with him. You didn't get hurt.
Talk to that Alder boy, huh?
I didn't mean to hit the kid.
Oh, I'm sick of your mouth.
All right, Novak, that's enough. Novak, I said that's enough.
Yeah.
Let go of him.
Mr.
Sandell?
Yeah, I see.
A few minutes ago, we could have booked him for murder.
We could have him now, Helmut.
Yeah. Saved the state some money, Novak. Neck's broken.
That's you, Patsy?
Over here, Father. On the step.
Hello, Inspector.
Father?
It's the man, Patsy.
Grandfather, that's him.
I'll pray for him, Patsy.
Why waste it, Father? It wasn't worth it.
They said the same thing about two men on a hill in Calvary.
After Mike Quinlan joined up with Sandell and his boys back in 1940, they pulled a bank job in Chicago. And instead of cutting in Mike on the tape, Sandell framed him to hit the rap for the three of them. Then Sandell came west to operate and lined up Quinlan's sister for his girlfriend. By the time Quinlan was paroled, he was fast on Sandell's game and he had lots to beef about. He lined up enough good evidence to put Sandell and his two boys away for life, and then he threatened to spill it. Sandell didn't cut him in for his share of the job and stay white of his sister. Sandell wasn't generous and he wasn't genteel, so he played along with his tenor's cheek and his gun in his pocket. When the time came to swap money for evidence, Quinlan picked the church for a trading ground and he was actually hidden in the box of the evidence. That's where we finally found it. The deal was all set to go when something scared Quinlan off and Sandell came in, mistook me for Quinlan, and quit little Jake. Sandell's boys tried to get at Quinlan through his girl, Sally Kimbrough, and when she wouldn't spill, they killed her and planted the body in my apartment to take care of it.